I'd now like to introduce the chairman of the MLK Celebration Committee, King County Councilmember Larry Gossett.
Thank you. I'd like to bring you greetings. As a politician, I'm able to bring greetings on behalf of all the people who live here in Martin Luther King County. So I'd like to bring you greetings on behalf of the 1.8 million people who reside here. Secondly, I want to do this right up front because the committee charged me. This is our 25th anniversary, and this is the first time that we've met at Franklin High School. As most of you, all right, we got some Quakers in the house. All right. But our committee especially wanted to thank the students and the staff leadership at Franklin for the outstanding hospitality that we've been greeted with in planning this celebration. I want to say to Jennifer and Bruce that there is a profound historic relationship as it relates to our community and our commitment to the legacy of Dr. King that's tied to Franklin High School. It was on March 29, 1968, that the first organized group of black students took over a school in relationship to gaining human rights within the public schools, and it was here at Franklin High School that they took over the school. And as a result, six people went to jail. Clifton Wyatt, who is here, Aaron and Elmer Dixon, Charles Oliver and Charles Flavors were the leaders of the BSU here at Franklin, and Ricky Gossett and yours truly, Larry Gossett, we all went to jail on that day. I mean, here's the nexus, because I got to move with the program. The nexus is that 5 days later, this is important, because the ruling class, the mayor, the school board, the rulers of Seattle said, this is a mess. We cannot allow our Negroes to upset our city like this. So they arrested the six of us on April 4th, 1964. We were all in jail by 9:30. At 1:30 that afternoon, an announcement came over that Martin Luther King Jr. had been killed in 68. Oh, I said 64. 1968, 5 days after the Franklin sit-in. Here's Charles Oliver. So that's the nexus. And the reason that we had to sit in, the principal, never will forget him, Lauren Ralph was his name, had kicked out two black girls for wearing their hair natural, said they can't come back until they look ladylike. So Franklin High School has come a long way. Now they paid for all of this. Franklin purchased all of our t-shirts, put signs announcing this rally all over the school, and we got dozens of Franklin students helping us to organize this event. Thank you very much. Now I just got 1 minute to mention our theme. Our theme is solidarity for peace, human rights, and economic justice. And every year we come up with a theme that we think that Dr. King would readily identify with, and it's our way of paying tribute and expressing solidarity with his legacy and keeping his dream going and keeping his legacy going by getting involved in direct action ourselves. A lot of people try to steal the essence, the meaning of Dr. King and his legacy. I was really proud that this morning we had a workshop on Martin Luther King as a radical thinker and actor, because when he died, he was talking about some radical stuff, y'all. And he wasn't just talking about liberating black people. He was against all forms of oppression. He came out against the war on Vietnam, so it's appropriate that peace is in our title. He was our nation's foremost leader for human rights. And he died. This is important because labor has been a very heavy supporter of ours every year to put on this event. 40% of the thousands of dollars that we raise each year to put this on is contributed by labor unions. So we're proud of that. So Martin Luther King, don't let anybody steal Dr. King's meaning from us. He related to all those things, labor, economic justice, small businesses doing better, human rights and peace. Let's keep the dream alive. Thank y'all for being here.
It now gives me great honor to introduce our next speaker, Lieutenant Ehren Watada. On June 22, 2002, in a rare case of officer dissent, a Fort Lewis lieutenant has refused orders to head out to the war in Iraq and faces court-martial up to 6 years.
Thank you for your support. I am honored and humbled to be speaking before you today. I thought that I might read from Martin Luther King Jr.'s speech, Beyond Vietnam, A Time to Break Silence. But reading just 3 minutes from these immortal words of such a courageous and honorable man would never do him justice. Therefore, I would encourage all of you to read this speech and contemplate if his words ring true today. It is important for you to understand that the war we fight today is for the exact same reasons 52,000 young Americans and 2 million Vietnamese perished in Southeast Asia. Wars like these will always be fought for arrogance, profit, and power for the chosen few among us. They will always use some cover, whether it be terrorism, communism, fascism, or whatever exploits the fear and hatred among us. Yet in the end, few will profit, and the masses, including the poorest and most desperate among us, will always pay. Will we allow this to continue, or will we stand up and say no more? Instead, I would like to read to you the words of former President Dwight D. Eisenhower. In no way is this meant to equate him with the legacy of Martin Luther King Jr., but it is to tell you of the timeless warning against those among us who seek power and greed always. It is the same warning issued by Dr. King. It is important to note that this president was a soldier just like myself. He knew firsthand the horrors and devastation of war that some within our society constantly clamor for. In 1953, as the Cold War carried on, he said this: "Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired signifies, in the final sense, a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed. This world in arms is not spending money alone. It is spending the sweat of its laborers, the genius of its scientists, the hopes of its children. The cost of one modern heavy bomber is this: a modern brick school in more than 30 cities. It is 2 electric power plants, each serving a town of 60,000. It is 2 fine, fully equipped hospitals. It is some 50 miles of concrete highway. This, I repeat, is the best way of life to be found on the road the world has been taken. This is not a way of life at all in any true sense. Under the cloud of threatening war, it is humanity hanging from an iron cross. But I will end with some words from Martin Luther King Jr. A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death. Indeed, war steals away our livelihood, our future, and the lives of our loved ones. We will never end terror with terror. To end terrorism, we must seize the policies of economic exploitation and inhumanity that causes others to despise us so. Until this happens, we will never know peace, we will never be free, and we will never become the country we were meant to be. Thank you.
I just wanted to announce that on February 5th, there will be demonstrations in front of Fort Lewis in the defense of Lieutenant Ehren Watada, so please come out and support. I'd now like to bring up to the mic Mary Flowers. Mary Flowers has been an anti-racist community organizer since the 1980s. She's a member of Village of Hope and a volunteer with the Black Prison Caucus at Monroe State Reformatory. Please welcome Mary Flowers.
Good afternoon. I want to read something from a sermon from Dr. King. Dr. King was a preacher. He was an activist. He was all those things. He was a father. He was a husband. And the dream is not dead. This is an excerpt from one of his sermons, Transform Nonconformist. Only through an inner spiritual transformation do we gain the strength to fight vigorously the evils of the world in a humble and loving spirit. The transformed nonconformist, moreover, never yields to the passive sort of patience, which is an excuse to do nothing. He recognizes that social change will not come overnight, yet he works as though the possibility of it was imminent, that it's just right before us. So we have to work without ceasing. I'm representing a lot of organizations. I'm also representing the choir you're about to hear. I can't sing, but I'm representing them because they belong to my church, and it's called Divine Purpose. And we have to have a divine purpose as we do this work. If this administration had a divine purpose, it would not be sending 21,000 additional troops to Iraq. If the city had a divine purpose, there'd be some meat to the race and social justice initiative of this city. There's some soul to it. If the housing authority had a divine purpose, they would not be uprooting folks at Yesler Terrace, Holly Park, in the way that they're uprooting them. Change might be imminent, but humane change is possible. And that's what divine purpose brings. We must have a divine purpose. It comes down to you and I. Do we have a divine purpose? Even as we march today. Even as we march, because I know with all these people in this room, somebody got on somebody's nerves today. But as we go forth, whether we get on one another's nerves or not, we have to have unconditional love. Because if we do not have that, we cannot have peace. We can't have the economic justice that we're talking about. I represent the Black Prisoners Caucus. They can't be here today because they're behind razor wire this morning. But they have called this school district to have a divine purpose. Not a whole bunch of money. They've called a school board to work cooperatively and to remember the faces of these children sitting down on this floor. We can't wait another generation. We have to do it now. And in terms of their divine purpose, they ask for three very simple things. Somebody in that class, because that's not about who the next superintendent is or who was on the school board. They said somebody in the school who loves them and cares about them. Get rid of the stigma of special education and have some curriculum that speaks to them. That's what they ask for. That's what we need for our children. That's divine purpose. That's my time. Thank you.
This next gentleman, certainly because I come from labor, I'd like to introduce the Secretary Treasurer of the King County Labor Council, David Freiboat.
Thank you, brother. Hello, everybody. My name is Dave Freiboat. I'm the Executive Secretary Treasurer of the Martin Luther King Jr. County Labor Council. I like the way that rolls off my lips. That was something that we did real early last year when it was time for a change. It was time for this progress to be made. And I'm going to try to get right to the point here because I was told that I had 3 minutes to talk about the history of the labor movement and civil rights. So, you know, but before I get started, I just want to preface it, this talk, with this and say that, you know, I grew up in Paulsville. I grew up out in the peninsula. I was a, when I showed up in Seattle in 87 as a business representative for the ferry workers, I was a pretty naive white boy. And I want to thank Tony Orange, who's here today, because when I first got into my first racial equality task force that the governor put together, because there was some stuff going on in the ferry system, Tony was the one that looked at this poor white boy and basically gave me the lowdown on what it meant, what was going on in society, what institutional racism was all about. And so I want to thank you for that, Tony, because you got my attention, you know. And so when I am dealing with labor people nowadays, and I don't know, maybe you folks deal with this, you get some white people that don't get it. I don't know if anyone's ever run into that. You know, white people that don't get it, and they go, what's with all this civil rights, Martin Luther King Day, you know? I mean, one of them said, what are you doing on Monday? And I said, I'm marching. I got my marching clothes on. I'm marching. And they, you know, they say, well, what is that? And I say, you know, let's start in the beginning. Slavery was a labor issue. I mean, duh, slavery was a labor issue. It was about the exploitation of people, of their labor. And you know, after slavery was outlawed, it didn't end, of course. The Jim Crow laws kept people down. And the exploitation in the North, the South we had the agricultural workers exploited. In the North we had the recent immigrants. My forebears that came in were exploited. And you know, the challenge in labor was to fight through our institutional racism. The stuff that we had to deal with as a class, as a working class, and rely on our progressives in the labor movement to give us vision so that we understood that it all came together and meant the same thing. And you know, I heard a recent speaker say that during the civil rights movement in the 60s, the secret weapon in that movement was progressive labor and progressive faith-based organizations. That was the secret weapon, the people that got it. And so to this day, my challenge and the challenge in the labor movement is to move forward that progressive thought, to make sure that people get it, that they understand where we came from and how this is about us being together, having unity in the face of exploitation, to deal head-on with our institutional racism that still exists to this day. And so that we can step forward and do things like change our name of our labor council in memory of one of the great martyrs, one of the people that gave their life so that we can have a better life. My time is up. Thank you for having me today.
Thank you. My name is Tia Fields. I'm actually I'm in the master's in teaching program at University of Washington. We need more teachers. I'm a proud graduate of Franklin High School as well. So I've been doing spoken word in this city for the last, I want to say, 8 years, and I hope you enjoy my piece. It's in honor of Dr. King. It's called Insomnia. Never cease to dream, but please do not sleep, as the first can be done without the other. Sometimes the pillows of progress or the blankets are better than lull us to dreamlands we mistake for equality. And our progress thus far is enough for some, maybe. But I still hear the ruckus made from student sit-ins and the spiritual saying from the street march-ins. And those sounds make it difficult to forget the feeling of struggle. Not that I passed a colored drinking fountain on my way here or was mauled by a police dog as I carried my We Shall Overcome sign. I just realized that the back of the bus wasn't a place sat on only in public transportation, but was a seat many like to take in life. Minority urban inner city at risk, underprepared, low-skilled statistics. Back of the bus, back of the class, glamorized lifestyles, worshiping class. Dreams, I hope you always have them, but make sure they're your own and no one has imagined them for you. Take stereotypes and hang them from the trees in honor of those who suffered their violence. Silence is like sleeping with eyes open wide. Killing the spirit of a person is like murder from inside. Even when they lie, still try. Sleep is a state of inactivity, no productivity, conscious ignorance, no progress made. Dream to envision possibility, the desire, purpose, value each day. If this is a movement, how come we haven't moved? I still hear that same student tell me he can't. I still hear the privilege yell, grab your bootstrap. I know this one guy who did it like that. This struggle is beautiful, protest and nonconformity, just looks and is expressed differently, sometimes exaggerated excessively with grills and platinum chains. But these hyper-glamorizations are remnants from which they came, and the hearts they know their royalty, kings and queens. The dangling jewelry's just all they've ever seen. Dream until the whole picture's shown. Dream until poverty doesn't live on our front door. Dream until we end war. Dream to end the ever-recurring cycles. Dream until education to all is vital. Dream to honor those who live today. Dream to save those who've gone astray. And when you dream, don't erase race. God dreams in color, and you should too. Dream until they don't add an equal opportunity here and a diversity there just to make you feel better. Dream until you know for a fact it's better. Dream until people love more than New York. Dream until racism isn't an American sport. Dream until our dreams become reality. Dream to affect the change you'll first have to be in whatever you do. Whatever you do, please do not sleep. Honoring those civil rights movers in their fight for peace. Dream. God bless you.
So depressed and confused all the time. It's like I don't care about anything anymore. All I want to do is watch Fox News all day. I feel like I don't even know what's going on around me.
If you are experiencing symptoms like these, you could be suffering from corporate fasciitis. Corporate fasciitis is a disorder that affects millions of Americans each year. You are not alone.
Doctor, causes this sickness?
Corporate fasciitis is an MTD. It's a media transmitted disease. Let's take a look. First of all, let's open up the mouth. Say ah.
Ah.
Good. Any other symptoms?
I feel afraid all the time.
You see, as mainstream media enters your head, the misinformation releases a contagion. This contagion triggers a process similar to brainwashing. This disorder, which spreads throughout the central nervous system and eventually throughout the entire body, causes extreme cynicism and social lethargy.
So my television's poisoning me.
Not just your television, unfortunately, but also the radio and print media.
So what can I do, Doctor?
Well, fortunately for you, there's an easy solution. What you need is Indimedia Presents. Why, with a weekly dose of independent media from Pepper Spray Productions, you can be back to your old self again, enjoying life, and most importantly, thinking for yourself.
Now I feel hopeful again, and I can take an active part in my community and the world around me. Thanks, Indimedia Presents.
Warning, regular ingestion of independent media may cause increased consciousness, acute political awareness, counter-hegemonic activity, enlarged cranial capacity, excessive hopefulness, and bloated critical thinking abilities. Ask your doctor if Indie Media Presents is right for you.
Lose their